You're listening to the Right Stream Radio Network, rejoicing in the flow of creativity. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Right Stream and hashtag Right Stream. Thanks for listening to the Right Stream Radio Network.
Partners in crime, they're partners in crime, in crime. Partners in crime, we're partners in crime. In crime, on a right stream.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Right Stream Radio Tuesday. We've got a really exciting show for you this afternoon. We're going to be talking about psychic investigations. And my partner, Sue Coletta. Say hi, Sue.
Hi.
Well, we've got an announcement to make in the beginning of the show. Our special guest, Sue, do you want to tell our listeners what's going on?
Sure. Our guest today, Richard Goodship, is flying somewhere over the Atlantic as we speak. At the last minute, his airlines changed his flight. I mean, totally out of his control. But he's going to join us next for the next show in January, so that'll be fun. In the meantime, it's just you and me, partner.
All right. Well, we're still going to have a really packed, jam-packed, exciting show and lots to talk about. And we wish Richard, obviously, great, safe travels. And we'll look forward to seeing him in January. That is going to be a really exciting show. He is just a super, super fun guy. So we're really going to look forward to that. So, Sue, before we start chatting about everything else, would you tell our listeners a little bit about A Crime Chat?
A Crime Chat, which is hashtag A Crime Chat on Twitter, is a bi-monthly chat for crime writers. We compiled seven experts and myself, and we answer questions for crime writers. So if somebody has, they're working on their novel and they don't know, say, what's the first thing they should do when their detective gets to the crime scene, they can ask, they tweet their questions to me using the hashtag, and I tweet them out to all of you, and you give the answer. It's like having experts at your fingertips. And we meet every other Wednesday. It's a lot of fun, isn't it?
Oh, it really is so much fun. And, I really think everybody gets a lot out of it. The writers, the detectives, it's just a really fun group. We definitely have a good time.
Yeah, especially when Joe always, never fails, towards like the 45-point mark, he screams for the barkeep, We do have a blast.
Joe is such fun. And just for our listeners, Joe Broadmeadow is one of our authors / retired detectives in the Crime Chat. And he is just a character and an excellent writer, too. I just really love his writing.
And he was our very first guest on Partners in Crime.
You're right. And what a guest. I mean, he just stole the show. We just were so grateful to have him, for sure.
He really did.
Yeah, he did. So can you also tell our listeners a little bit about the Run, Scream, Die series that we're collaborating on?
Oh, that's a fun project. There's 10 of us. And I have the book right here so I can name all the authors. Caleb Pirtle, which some people might remember from the Kenny Rogers movie, The Gambler. He wrote that and 70-plus odd novels. Myself, Kim, Rachel Ox, Jennifer Chase, Christine Mason, Paul Dale Anderson. He is a big name in horror. Kathy Love, Joe Broadmeadow, and L. Rossi. It's a trilogy, and the whole trilogy has the underlying fear element, hence the titles Run, Scream, Die. And the second one, Scream, will release on Valentine's Day, and that also has an underlying love story, or however we want to twist that love story.
Right, wow. And back to, go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm done. Go ahead.
Back to Caleb Pirtle, I didn't realize, so he actually wrote the book for the movie The Gambler?
Yes, he wrote the screenplay too.
You're kidding. I did not even know that. That's fascinating.
I know. He's got several, he's had a few, well, not several, but definitely a good handful of movie adaptations from his books. Amazing, right?
Wow. That is so amazing. You know, that was one of my favorite songs when I was little, was The Gambler by Kenny Rogers.
Me too. Me too. So funny.
Oh, that is so
surprising.
Well, I'm going to have to stalk Caleb in Facebook now that I know he's famous.
Right. Exactly.
Oh, that's so great. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so where can our audience find the Run series?
It's on all the book sites, Barnes & Noble, iBooks, Amazon, Kobo. I'm missing some. What am I missing? Well, you know, all the digital.
Yeah.
But,
all the main ones.
Yeah. The easiest way is just type into your browser my.BOOK/run2, and it'll bring you to the Amazon in your country.
Oh, perfect. Oh, that's great. And, you know, kind of going into this whole, issue of this collaboration book, how can you tell our audience, like, how did you get into writing in the first place? Like, when did this all start for you?
Oh, gee. Well, you know, even since I was very little, I could always write. I could always communicate better with the written word than speaking, believe it or not, because I never shut up. But, you know, even when I got into trouble, like with my parents, when I was little, I'd go in my room and I'd write a letter. And, you know, I'm sure I fudged some excuses in there as well, and then I would slip it underneath their door, and it worked every time. So I mean, I kind of got that really quick, that the written word can get you out of a lot of stuff. So then in my 20s, right? So then in my 20s, I wrote children's books, believe it or not. It's a jump from crime, but it all started because I had this bugger of a boyfriend, and I wanted to get my point across by being, you know, passive aggressive. I'd make him a character in the story, and you know, each one had a theme, like, don't think you're so cool that you don't need anybody because you do, and that, you know, that type of thing. And I must have written over a dozen of them, but my passion, yeah, they were fun. And my grandchildren now tell me that I need to rewrite them for them, which,
Sweet.
Yeah. I'm perfect show and tell, right?
Oh, no doubt.
Right? That, you know, I'm in a book. So,
yeah.
I've always loved crime, though. So when we moved to New Hampshire, and I was really inspired to try writing a novel. So that's what I did.
And how far back are we going? When did you write your first novel?
My first novel, I want to say it's like 5.5 years now. It will never see the light of day, but I may reuse the title and the murders. You know, it's your learning novel. So.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I have five that are actually trunked for life. I told my husband, if anything ever happens to me, under no circumstances do these ever get released ever. I really should.
I love it. Oh, I love it. So what was the first work that you actually published?
The first novel to get published was Marred. That was my very first. And that was that was published in 2015.
What an amazing, I
was
just
a great
tell you how much. Oh, what a great, I mean, that is just such a well-written, exciting, it's just such a great book. I can't even say enough about it. I loved it so much.
Thanks.
Do you want to, it's just wonderful. Do you want to tell everybody just, you know, kind of a little bit about the story?
Well, the story is about Sage Quintano, who's a crime writer. She's married to a homicide detective, Nico, in Boston. When she gets attacked by the serial killer Nico's hunting, he finds her in their Boston living room and attacks her and scars her in ways she never even thought imaginable. And the book opens when she's at the funeral of her unborn child. It's kind of a heartbreaking prologue, really. And then the story jumps ahead 3 years, and they have moved to New Hampshire, a really rural, quiet community. Sheriff is now, Nico is now the sheriff, and Sage is still a best-selling crime writer. And a murder spree happens, hits their town. A serial killer stalks their streets. And Sage notices similarities in the murders to the Boston serial killer. And then the phone calls start. And she knows he's come back to finish the job. And it goes from there. It's fun. And the next one in the series is called Cleaved, which I just submitted to my publisher. That should be out March, April.
Wow, I can't wait. So that's going to be out in the spring.
Yeah, yeah.
And just because I'm curious, can you give us a little hint about Cleaves? Like anything, you know, that might be in there?
You know, it's funny because when I signed the contract, I didn't, I in the spot that says, supply your book description, I said, you know, I'll write this later, because it's a hard book to explain without ruining Mard. But briefly, I can say,
gotcha.
Yeah, there's some things in there that would spoil Mard. So I can say that Frankie Campanelli, which is Nico's snarky deputy. She's got such a smart aleck, isn't she? I love her. She's got her own storyline. There's a serial killer stalking the streets again, and he never kills the same way. So it's very difficult to pinpoint if there's one serial killer or two, except all the bodies are missing their left hand, and all the bodies are found with the King of Hearts playing club, playing card.
Whoa.
So, yeah, something happens to Sage and Nico, something happens to Frankie, but I really haven't figured out how to express that in a description yet.
That's so true. You're right, because now is this going to be a trilogy or is this going to be a series?
It's going to be a long-standing series, only because I love the characters so much.
Oh, me too, definitely. I mean, I just don't even see how you could get rid of those characters. They're right. So lovable. They really are. And, you know, I didn't even think about that, but you're right, because in order to describe it, you don't want to give away the prior books in the series. So that definitely can be challenging, I bet.
Yeah, and when you're writing it, you know, you really got to make each book be able to stand on its own as well. So
right.
It's very, very tricky. I mean, you know, some things you know, some things you have to give away because otherwise you can't tell the story. But the first book, there's plenty in there for the first book anyway, so.
How great. Now, your second series starts off with Wings of Mayhem. Can you tell us a little bit about that one?
Wings of Mayhem. That's the Mayhem series. And Wings of Mayhem is about Shawnee Daniels, who is about as sarcastic as they come. She's very rough around the edges. During the day, she works at the Revere Police Department in cybercrimes. And at night, she moonlights as a cat burglar, but she targets people responsible for fraud, like Jack Delzin, who's the killer, which you know from the first chapter. I'm not giving anything away. He embezzled his retirement, his employee's retirement fund. So that's why she targets him. When she's in his house, she steals this cool puzzle box that she loves. But then she finds his lair and realizes, oh my God, I'm in a serial killer's house. And she takes off. Unfortunately for her, Jack had a hidden camera. So he knows who she is. And he wants that cool puzzle box is actually his trophy box, and he wants it back. And, you know, it goes from there. Shawnee can't find it, of course. So it's a real cat and mouse back and forth with chapters from Jack and then alternating chapters with Shawnee. And then the underlying investigation, excuse me, with the Detective Levon Samuels and all that goes along with that. So it was a fun book to write.
I just think it is so clever how you make the cop kind of a bad girl too. I just think that is brilliant. I love that so much.
Oh, you wouldn't call her goody good, but I mean, deep down under all those rough layers, she's a good person at heart. But on the surface, she's just a streetwise, tough, will sucker punch you in a moment type of chick.
Right. I love it. I love that so much. So for our listeners out there that are, you know, contemplating becoming a writer or starting to write a book, what advice can you give them as far as things that you've learned and, you know, kind of the pros and cons?
Pick a different profession. I mean,
right?
Because I say that because authors as you know, we work 24/7. I mean, we really have to, between writing new books and marketing and being social on social media. It's signings. It's nonstop, right?
You're so right. It's overwhelming sometimes.
It really can be. So, I mean, unless somebody really has that yearning to write, they shouldn't do it.
Right. Exactly.
You know?
So it really has to be more for the desire or almost the need to write.
Yes.
As opposed to maybe a career choice.
Exactly. Yeah. You don't wake up and say, gee, I'd like to write books for a living. Wouldn't that be fun? Because penning the actual stories is fun, as you know, but, you know, the rest of it, it's work.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. What would you say some are the biggest pitfalls that you run into as far as maybe your expectations versus how it actually really is?
Oh, well, just getting published was soul crushing because, you send out that first novel, you think you've written magic when actually you've written crap, but you don't know that. you don't have the experience to go along with that yet. So then you get rejection letters, and some of them are not nice. You know, some of them are blunt. So growing a thick skin, I think that's number one, right? Wouldn't you say?
Oh, sure. Oh, absolutely. You really have to have a thick skin. And even if you've written a good piece, sometimes you can get rejected for a multitude of reasons. It's the wrong genre, or it's, you know, for whatever reason, they're not taking new projects. But the thick skin, I think, is absolutely critical because you will get a lot of doors slammed in your face.
A lot, yes. I even had action on Wings of Mayhem from this other publisher who said, the only reason she's saying no is because she wants her protagonist squeaky clean. I mean, seriously? Who wants a squeaky clean protagonist? Yeah.
That's so boring.
Right?
Yeah.
Boring.
Are you seriously?
Yeah. Thank God the other publishers disagreed. But, I mean, this is the nonsense. Or if they have, you know, if they've just bought a book that's just like yours, there could be absolutely nothing wrong with yours, and yet you get rejected because they have something that's way too similar. You know, that happens
absolutely.
A lot, too.
Yeah, that is so true.
It's not easy. And anybody who tells you, oh, I just let those comments roll off the back, have never let their soul write the book. You know, because don't you really think, I mean, when we write, we're in our own little world. And it's really like our soul that's writing that book. We're pouring our emotions onto the page, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely. It really is. You're really kind of making yourself vulnerable because in some ways yourself comes out almost in all of your characters. And it's almost like someone calling your baby ugly when they reject your book.
Exactly. You have to get used to it because, you know, you might get that, thank God this hasn't happened to me, but I've heard horror stories of people getting slammed in reviews where, you know, they just tear the book apart. And it goes with the gig. Unfortunately. So, you know, what I do is when I was getting rejection letters all the time, I would just, you know, read them, take a minute, absorb it. If there was any good advice in there, because sometimes agents and publishers will say, you know, they'll give you a tip here and there about what they liked or what they didn't or what you can work on, you know, take that advice. And then give yourself like an hour and then move on. But let yourself, you know, be bummed out. Because it's...
Yes. Yeah, and I think you're right. I think there's that, yeah.
You have to, don't you think? I mean, you don't want to get...
I think it's a really... Yeah, it's a great balance.
Yeah, you don't want to get jaded. So you really need to kind of pick yourself back up, dust yourself off, and move on.
Right. And but you're right, though, when you first read it, you do want to give yourself just that little bit of, I don't know if sadness is the right word, maybe a little grieving almost, just to let yourself feel that emotion of rejection. And I think that way, too, doesn't it also enhance that feeling when someone says, hey, we want you? And
Absolutely. That's
just, yeah. So
Absolutely. Can
you maybe explain that, like that first time somebody said, hey, we want your book? That must have just been such a thrill.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's kind of funny because, I imagined for a couple of years that, you know, fireworks would shoot from the sky. You'd get a phone call, and on the other end would be a publisher, an agent who's so excited. You're the next literary god. You know what I mean? I mean, you build it up in your head that it's going to be this magnificent event. And what it actually ended up being was an email. And on the table at my husband, I said, oh my God, I think I just scored a publishing deal. And he's like, what? I mean, it was kind of a letdown, like a major letdown. And I had to, you know, just turn the computer and say, are you reading the same thing I am? I mean, the contract's attached. Is, you know, where's the fireworks? Where are the balloons? Where's the champagne? But, you know, it can be very anticlimactic in that regard because you've daydreamed something way better. But often it ends up, you know, being an email.
That, I love it.
It's funny great. Because, you know, so many writers, I mean, the whole time you're I love the expression, the slush pile, because it's so apt that we're trying to claw our way to the top of the slush pile. I mean, the imagery just really fits, don't you think?
Oh, it really does. It really does. Oh, my gosh. Well,
and then when
I think
you
this
finally get out,
time.
You get an email. You know?
Yeah.
<It's> like, that's it?
Right. I love it. Oh, my gosh. Well, I think this might be a good time to take a little break. So I'm Kimberly McGath talking with my partner, Sue Coletta. We're partners in crime, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Hi, I'm Diane.
And this is Denise.
And we want to invite you to listen to the History Goes Bump podcast.
Ghost tours for the theater of the mind.
The History Goes Bump podcast. A show featuring a look at historic locations, people, and events with a twist. This history podcast is haunted. So grab your slippers, hot chocolate, flashlight, and maybe even that baseball bat, and join us.
You can find the show at iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, and other various podcast catchers.
Check out the website at historygoesbump.com.
Keep it spooky.
Welcome back to Partners in Crime on Right Stream Radio. I'm Kimberly McGath talking to my co-host, Sue Coletta, award-winning author, and we're just kind of going through, what life is like as an author. And Sue, could you maybe walk our audience through what a typical day would be like for you as a writer?
A typical day. The first thing I do, I get up very early. I like to get up at like 4 because that's my best writing time. So especially...
Wow.
You know, if I'm working on a novel at the time that I'm really into. I usually write from like 4 to 6. Then I'll relax and read for like an hour or so. And then I'll, while I drink my tea, I'll jump on Facebook and be social and laugh and joke. And I do that and then stroll through Twitter. And then come 9 o'clock, I really need to be back writing again. So I will write some more till about lunch. Then lunch, I market my books, and, you know, the cycle just continues. And then, you know, during the day, as you know, we have to multitask like a million things. I only post once a week on my blog now because, honestly, I don't have time any more than that. So, you know, if it's that day, that can take all day to write that.
Right.
So, but, you know, I don't want to give the impression that being a writer is a bad thing, because I would never want to do anything else.
Right.
But it's a lot of work.
I think it is, and I think probably a lot of people on the outside may be wanting to get into this profession. I guess it's maybe just like the type of thing you almost have to get into it to learn how grueling it can be. And like you said, we really have to multitask a lot. So you may be working on a blog at the same time you're communicating with other writers, you're doing posts on Twitter, you're reading someone else's work, posting reviews for other authors. It really is a very time-consuming profession, and I think it can take a lot of your personal time too. Like how long of a day? Like, so you get up at 4. When are you done?
7.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a really long day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And my poor husband, you know, he. I'm trying to do better. I'm trying to stop at 6, but it never really works that way. But from day one,
right.
I've always made the rule that my nights belong to him, and no matter what, this computer is shut off at 7, and I don't care if the world blows up. It's his time.
Right.
And I really think you have
right.
to do that.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's really important to have that off time so your mind can kind of take a break and, you know, spend time with your loved ones and almost kind of regroup, especially because we both write about very gruesome material, and maybe share that with us. Does that ever affect you?
No. Well, it never did until, it only did once, I should say.
Okay.
With your background, you're more, you know, you got all that firsthand experience of being a detective. So we'll get into that. I mean, how you even dealt with that. But as a crime writer, right? As a crime writer, you know, in order to write about serial killers and murders, you know, we really have to, like, watch autopsies. And I, you know, watched a whole thing about the body farm and watched a body decompose over a year's time, which was fascinating, by the way.
Usually
I'm so fascinated that it doesn't bother me. But this past
right.
summer, I went to the Writers Police Academy.
Oh,
and
right.
Yeah, it was awesome, too. Highly recommend it to anybody. In my death investigations class, they showed us a real, was he a serial killer? Well, if he wasn't a serial killer, he was definitely a budding serial killer. And he mutilated this poor woman beyond, I mean, just, wow, did he mutilate her. And the crime scene photos really stuck with me. They still stick with me. And I don't know why that particular case stuck with me when I've seen numerous other cases and crime scene photos. But this
right.
sicko, you know, he gutted her from the neck to the navel, down both legs to the knee, and then with her own lipstick down one leg wrote an eye for an eye, and down the other leg wrote a life for a life. And then he left his knife inside her, we'll say. You can use your imagination.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
That's interesting,
so
that he would kind of, yeah, and it's weird that he would bring up almost like that Code of Hammurabi, Old Testament type of sentiment. Did they ever get to the bottom of the meaning behind that?
Well, you know the strange part about that sentiment? It was stranger on stranger. And
really?
I mean, that makes me think personal, right?
Sure,
like,
right. Right.
And it was this guy who called an escort service. And he did this to the escort. So he had never seen her before. So I think he was probably killing someone else in his mind. Do you think?
Sure. Yeah, possibly. Or maybe it was just part of his fantasy base for whatever reason. But very interesting sentiment. So they did solve that case?
They did, yes. Yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah. He killed her in his hotel room. He used his own name to check in. And
what an idiot.
Yeah. That really was very smart. And he was still there. He didn't leave.
Right. Oh, wow.
I mean, standing next to a body all bloody. Gee, I wonder who did this. But I think he wanted to get caught because he kind of wanted everybody to know what he did. He was proud of it.
Right. Right.
You know?
Almost like braggadocious almost.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very... Yeah, interesting. That's a very interesting case. Why don't you tell everybody a little bit about the academy that you went to and what the purpose is and kind of, is it a week long?
It's not. I wish it was. It's 4 days,
okay.
A Thursday through a Sunday. They always have it in August.
Okay.
And the location used to change, but now they've found their home in Wisconsin at the Real Police Academy, which is cool.
Okay. Yeah,
the
very
whole
cool.
The whole time you're there, spontaneous crimes, like, erupt around you. So, like, a woman can run by you mugged, which is, so it's very interactive. There was a fatal car crash that happened. Yeah, and they had life support. They hire these actors to play the victims. And with that fatal car crash, the mother screaming when she saw her son dead on the windshield. Even though you know logically these are actors, it just goes right through you.
Oh,
amazing.
Yeah, that's chilling just thinking about that.
And then we had a terrorist attack, too, which was wicked fun. The cops
stormed.
Yeah, they stormed the, I guess, auditorium, you'd call it. We were all there for a group class because usually you get to pick which classes you want to attend, and they all happen simultaneously, so everyone's kind of going their own way, and it's all hands-on. But at this particular time, we had a group meeting, and all of a sudden, SWAT kicks in the door, and they flood the place, and they're yelling for us to lace our fingers on our head because they're looking for this terrorist. So much fun.
Oh, yeah, the shock and awe of SWAT is just gets you every time.
And they were so impressive. I mean, even afterwards, just the way they stand was so impressive. I was amazed.
And
I took pictures of them just so I could remember that stance.
What a brilliant setup for writers, you know, who want to put authenticity into their books and to actually be able to, you know, you could really draw from those real life, you know, or seemingly real life experiences. I think that's just brilliant.
Oh, it really is. really, really is.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, that's great. And I bet they have a great turnout.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They usually sell out within a couple of hours.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
What fun. How long have you been going to that?
This past summer was my first time because I always missed it. They sell out so darn quick. But this past time, tickets were to go on sale at 12, and at 12, I was like right there on the website with the click. Yeah, so
that's
I made
great.
It. Yeah.
I love it.
Worth it. Definitely worth it.
And you know, that brings up a really good point because, you know, and I know you have one of your books is Crime Writers Research. Can you maybe explain what the process that you go through to research, whether it's for a particular book or for your blog or, you know, just writing in general, but particularly with the crime writing, what process do you go through?
Well, I'm a research junkie, as you know. I can get lost for days in my, you know, and literally the whole world just like falls away because I'm down the rabbit hole, so, you know, somewhere else.
Right.
I usually, if I need something that I come across in my work in progress, I have been known to bother you.
I love it.
What's that blue fog that 10 people have? And, you know, you'll give me the answer. And then I can, you know, it gives me a good starting point because then I can go from there, you know, look for ocular clouding rather than what's the blue fog. You know what I mean?
Right.
And then that's where Crime Chat comes in, too, because you guys give us the terminology. So that leads to all kinds of research. But, yeah, one thing usually leads to the next and the next and the next. And then the next thing you know, this just happened with Blessed Mayhem. Mr. Mayhem, who's introduced in that book, has a pet crow named Poe.
Oh, love it.
And, you know, I thought, gee, I wonder what's special about crows. I got lost. For hours, hours. And I found out so many fascinating things that I ripped the entire book apart so I could build it around everything I learned. But it's worth it in the end. Yeah.
Oh, it really is. And, you know, I'm the same way, too. That's always been my favorite thing with investigations is research. And to me, just that little nugget of you find that one thing that's just so hard to find. I love that about my cold cases, you know, just fascinating to find that something that would almost be impossible, like a newspaper clipping from 1955, you know, something like that. I just am so enthralled with research. It's my favorite thing to do.
You actually have quite a gift. Because I don't know if our listeners realize this about you, but you can see things that a lot of people miss. And I've seen it in action, and it's amazing. Remember when I had to write that for the Writers Police Academy, I had to write a 200-word story with a clear hook, middle,
Yes.
And they gave us a picture, and I thought, I know exactly what to do. So I gave it to you. And wow, the details. You came back. I mean, what did you give me? 2 pages worth of details from the picture? It was amazing.
That's so sweet.
I don't even know what kind of paper it was, for crying out loud. I was blown away.
I love that. I love puzzles, and I love just that, you know, I've been known to stare at crime scene photos for hours because it is absolutely incredible how you can look at a picture 100 times And then that 101st time, you see something totally different. It's fascinating. I just, yeah, I've always really enjoyed that, you know, that kind of finding that little piece, or that's, it's really definitely, I love that. Very fascinating, for sure.
And you definitely have a gift for it, too.
Oh, you're so sweet.
You really
Thank
do.
You. So how long would you say, now that you're an experienced writer, how long would you say from start to finish, the second you think of a title or the moment you start typing, how long would it take you to finish a book, would you say?
It takes me about 3 months. From
Wow, that's not bad. Wow.
It's not bad. But that's from the initial idea, and I plan it out using an Excel spreadsheet so that I have, you know, it's structured properly. Once it's structured properly, you know, it kind of falls into place. The hardest part I have is knowing when to stop picking at it, because I could pick at it forever. And sometimes you have to, you know, you at some point you have to say, okay, enough. But I wrote Cleaved in 2 months, actually.
Oh, that's about how long it takes me to write a short story.
Well, you know, Blessed Mayhem, that one's been a bitch. I said it in the summer. And I'm still not done, because I kept thinking of better and better ideas and kept ripping it apart, redoing it, ripping it apart, redoing it. So, you know, sometimes it can last, you know, 6 months, but, you know.
Right, but that's amazing. I just think that's incredible.
Well, sometimes, you know, the book just flows. And other times, it's like pulling teeth, you know? So I guess it depends on the book you're writing.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and maybe how attached you are to it, too, I think could have something to do with it. It's so true. Now, you've also written 60 Ways to Murder Your Characters.
That was fun.
Can you tell us a little, like, what, how you came up with that idea and what, you know, what that, you know, entails?
Well, I have a crime resource blog, and it started as, I wonder how many different ways of murder I could do for my blog. But then, like always, I got lost in my research and came and just kept coming up with newer and cooler ways. And so I put that book together. But I did start also with, you know, common things like gunshots and stab wounds. And the only reason I did that was because I thought it was, you know, that is definitely a means of murder. And I wanted to give writers what happens when you stab someone, that the muscles of the stomach will, you know, suck in that knife. It's not just, you know, stab and go. And if it gets bloody, your hand's going to, killer's hand's going to slip. So I really filled it with a lot of that information in there. I even have the exact ingredients of how to dissolve a body in there.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
But, you know, it was fun.
Oh, it sounds like it. Now that's a guide, right? So that would be something like someone that is interested in writing about crime in fiction that they could purchase to actually help them kind of murder their characters, correct?
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, a lot of them I'll say, you know, have your killer do this if he wants to get caught, to give your detective a fair shot, or have him do this so he won't get caught. So yeah, it's definitely a guide, but I tried to include, you know, extras so that it could work in your novel. Some of the some of the ways are really out there. And I actually had a reviewer that said, most of these I would never use in my work. And I thought, really? Wow, I'd use them all. All. We must write totally different books. But yeah,
maybe their character is like a soft killer.
Yeah, they must write cozy mysteries or something.
Rather than right.
Like serial killers that we love.
I love it. That is so funny. And do you get a lot of feedback like with these type of guides that you write? Do you have a lot of people writing in and saying, oh, you know, they use this in their book or anything like that?
You know, I haven't encountered that yet, but I do get nonstop questions like you. People, and I love helping my fellow writers. I am all for it.
Right.
But, you know, some days you get inundated with, you know, one question after the other. And, yeah, I'm not a cop. I'm just a research junkie, you know. So I try to tell them, you know, this is what I found, but definitely, you know, check my facts. Because, you know, what if I told them something that was wrong, you know?
Right.
I would be horrified.
Exactly.
I've been known to bug you, too, and say, oh, I just got this question. What's the answer? Matt, we did that last week, right?
That's okay, because I bug you about the writing part, so it kind of is a win-win. I love it. I love it. And what about The Reckoning? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Oh, The Rendering. That is...
That's The Rendering, yes.
Rendering. And it's funny because I almost used The Reckoning.
Oh, how funny.
Is that weird?
That is weird.
That's a collection of dark flash fiction. I really let my inner serial killer go on that one. I love writing flash fiction. And for anyone who doesn't know, those are stories under 1,000 words. And they have to have a real hook. A real middle twist and a middle shift and a twist ending. And they're a great way to test out a different character that's maybe you don't know if it is worthy of a full novel yet or not. And I will say that that's exactly how I ended up with Mr. Mayhem, is from one of the stories in The Rendering. It wouldn't leave me alone. I kept hearing the killer's voice, and he was really begging for his own story. So that's how he made it into Blessed Mayhem.
That is so fascinating. And don't you think, in a way, writing 1,000 words can be harder sometimes?
Yeah. Yeah, oh, definitely. Because, you know, every word counts. So there's no time to ramble. It's actually a great exercise for novelists, because we're used to being able to have 300 pages to tell the story. And you can't with flash fiction or even the short story like our stories in Run. We had a 10,000-word cutoff, so we had to make sure, you know, the words, they were the right words and no filler words, you know.
Is that, yeah, and I think that can just be really challenging to keep it under, especially 1,000, because, you know, that can just be really difficult, I think. But you're right, that probably is such a great platform for new writers to really start getting into, you know, because sometimes a novel can be so daunting, you know, writing, you know, 300 pages. So if you start off with the smaller works, and like you said, they could blossom into a wonderful novel.
Yes. They really, and you know what else? It's a nice break when you're slogging along in your novel and, you know, you have this, all writers have a million ideas, you know, and it's a great way to kind of get it out of your head, see if it works, and it's a nice change from novel writing. And I write them all the time just to kind of either test a new character or get the idea out of my head because it keeps pestering at me, you know? But,
right.
Yeah, they're a lot of fun, I think.
Oh, absolutely. And you mentioned Run. Can you tell us a little bit about your story, The Blackout?
The Blackout is about Blue and Jake. Oh, my God. What is their last name?
Carpaccio, Hello? Right?
Carpaccio. There you go.
Yeah, I love that name.
they live actually... You know, I stole them from my very first novel. They started my
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
So never throw anything away because you never know what you can use later. They live
Absolutely.
On Bearcat, right? They live on Bearcat Mountain
yeah.
with four other residents. And somebody or something is killing the residents off one by one during a blackout. In a 24-hour period. That's it in a nutshell. Your story, repeat. Why don't you tell us about the sideshow?
Oh, yeah. The sideshow is about a young girl who goes to the circus in a small town, and she encounters a lot of kind of gruesome murders at the circus, and there's kind of like a lot of speculation as to who might be doing the murders, and yeah, it's a little creepy. A lot of clowns.
It really is. I mean, the way you wrote it, I can like hear that creepy circus music.
Ugh. Yeah,
love that.
Oh.
And you wrote the next one already. Teacher's Pet.
Yeah, I'm almost done. I know, right? Yeah. It was a really fun one to write because it was different than Sideshow. It's just, you know, basically like a kind of whodunit, but really a lot of fun. And it's called The Silent Widow. So it's about a widow who's been arrested for poisoning her husband. So, but there's a lot of twists and turns. And, yeah, it's pretty cool. It was really fun, though. I really enjoyed writing it.
Love
and,
the title.
Oh, hey. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Mystery Thriller Week. Can you fill our listeners in on what that's about and how they can get involved?
Absolutely. Mystery Thrillers Week happens in February. But the dates kind of seem like it's 2 weeks, doesn't it? Oh. I know we're scheduled for the 14th, but it does seem like it's 2 weeks, right?
Yeah, maybe it's Mr. Thriller Weeks.
Maybe. But a bunch of mystery thriller authors, including me and Kim, we're doing kind of author takeover Facebook events. And we have the 14th from 2 to 4. And Joe weaseled in on our time.
Great. I love it.
He's probably listening, so I just wanted to give him a little, you know, jab.
Absolutely.
And all kinds of fun stuff is happening already because all of the books are up for review. So book reviewers can pick from the list and review any book they want. There's a ton of authors involved. We're
yeah.
doing interviews, spotlights, author takeover events on Facebook, all kinds. And there's stuff for writers too. I forget what her name is. She wrote Twitter for Writers. Her name's running through my tongue.
Is it Victoria?
No. Jeepers Crow. It'll come to me. Anyways.
Okay.
Yeah, she's doing some instructional Facebook events for writers. Yeah, so that's really nice, too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, what a...
others are doing marketing advice during their event.
Yeah, very nice. And what a great group of people, don't you think?
Oh, they're the best. They are the best.
They
so
really
nice.
Are. So wonderful. And for anyone out there who wants to check it out, they can go to mysterythriller.com to get more information.
And look them up on Facebook under groups, Mystery
yes.
Thriller,
Mystery Thriller
Writers.
Week.
Week,
yes.
Right. There you go.
Yes, and yeah, there's a bunch of sign-ups, and it's just a really great group of people, and there's really just a lot of resources for both readers and for writers. So it's really really an exciting thing they're doing, and very impressed with them.
Me too.
Yeah, okay. Well, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back, and we're going to talk about psychic investigations.
What's your story? Rightstream Publishing knows everyone has a valuable story to share with the world. Is it a real-life experience, a memoir, or other type of nonfiction? Or maybe a fictional tale that's been living in your imagination? Rightstream Publishing can help you bring it to life. With affordable publishing packages that include professional editing, customized cover design, ISBN assignment, Library of Congress control number, and formatting for paperback and ebook, Rightstream Publishing offers the best value in indie publishing. As seasoned social media and marketing professionals, we consult with you on a personalized strategy to get your book noticed. And we don't stop there. Rightstream Radio Network provides an opportunity for our authors to connect with their readers with on-air interviews broadcasting daily with 7 unique programs. You just can't get all this anywhere else. Visit rightstreampublishing.com for more information and to set up your no-obligation consultation. Again, that's rightstreampublishing.com.
And we're back with Partners in Crime. I'm Kimberly McGath, and I'm talking to award-winning author Sue Coletta, my co-host. And we are going to actually talk about psychic investigations. And Sue, what do you think as far as kind of on the beginning side of the psychic spectrum would be woman's intuition? Have you had some experience with that?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. My intuition screams at me sometimes. Doesn't yours? Do you think men experience men intuition?
You know, I guess that's a good question. I think they probably do. And maybe there's a reason why they termed it women's intuition. Maybe women are a little bit more in touch with that side, just maybe based on that old, you know, hunter-gatherer versus, you know, the woman's role. I mean, I'm sure that's changed in modern times considerably, but maybe women are slightly more in touch with their intuition. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree. I saw an interesting study on male and female brains. It was a TED Talk. I love those. And the different parts of the brain lit up when posed with the same question for a male as a female, which I found very, very interesting. The female applied emotion to almost that sort of thing, where the male brain didn't. It could stay more detached, which I found interesting.
Yeah,
so
probably not surprising. You know, I jokingly call my husband sometimes an android.
Right?
Because it just seems like, you know, sometimes something that I would put emotion into, he'd be like, whatever.
Exactly. So that probably has to do, same thing with intuition, I would think, if they got more in touch with their Y chromosomes, maybe they would be more in touch with their intuition. Have you had any experience? Let's hear a story from you. Enough talking about me. Let's turn the spotlight on.
Oh, boy.
Kimberly McGath.
Definitely as a mother. I've had some very strong intuition type experiences where almost more like a premonition. In one situation, my daughter was in high school, and she was out staying with some friends. And for some reason, I was just like, I have to call her right now and check on her. And
wow.
the mother answered the phone. And she said, you know, we were just talking about what the girls were doing. And my daughter had actually gone out the night before, but she didn't tell me. So,
oh.
And, you know, I was, yeah. Surprise. Yeah. And I was a pretty liberal parent. It wasn't really like me to get upset. But I got this overwhelming feeling to bring her home. So I briefly yelled at her and insisted that she come home. She was very upset with me, of course, because this was she was supposed to be at the friends for a week for spring break. And I said, no, you have to come home. You know, I insisted, and usually I gave in, but I insisted this time, and I just had this weird feeling. Well, unfortunately, 2 days later, the girls that she would have been staying with, they all got in a fatal car wreck. So that was, yeah, it was
wow.
Horrifying. Yeah, absolutely horrifying. And then we talk about it to this day because just the way the circumstances, you know, even things I shared with her when she got home, like I just have this bad feeling, you know, blah, 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 blah. So when I tell my kids, it doesn't happen often, but when I tell them, hey, I just have a bad feeling about you doing such and such, they actually won't, they'll cancel their plans.
Smart. Now, how did it happen? Were you home and it just kind of struck you or, you know, how did the incident?
Yeah. It was so strange. I was just sitting on my porch, daydreaming, you know, going through my normal to-do list in my mind, and it just hit me out of nowhere. Call Jesse. So, it was just an instant thing that just came to my head, and it was very strange and very, very eerie experience, very tragic, too, unfortunately, for those poor kids. Just heart-wrenching, you know, just a parent's worst nightmare. And another experience I had was my mother and my sister and I, this was going back, about 10 years ago, we were flying out to see my brother out in St. Louis. And I'm not, as you know, I'm not a big fan of flying.
Yeah.
But I was all fine with it. We had a couple drinks at the bar. I was ready to get on that plane. And we were sitting waiting for, to get on to board. And at the last minute, the gate changed. They changed our gate. And I'm kind of funny with numbers. And they changed the gate to a number which was a code for death for my police department.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
So I told my mom and my sister, I said, look, I don't want to get on. I've got this overwhelmingly bad feeling. Something really bad's going to happen. And I called my husband, and we talked about it. And he's like, oh, it's probably just your nerves. You know, just get on the plane. Well, long story short, there was 2 fires on the plane.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, but it actually worked out pretty well because of my experience in law enforcement, I actually smelled the fire right away because the first fire was an electrical fire. And, you know, it's a very distinct, almost like a burnt plastic smell.
Oh.
So I alerted the male steward, and he was able to, you know, get it taken care of in time, because I guess once the physical fire started, apparently there's a time limit on distinguishing the fire, which I didn't know at the time. But we did that whole emergency dive landing.
Oh, my God. So why did you get on the plane rather than skip it?
I guess I went with my gut, which was to get on, even though I didn't want to.
Because
something,
you thought,
something, Yeah, I don't know why. I just felt like I needed to get on the plane, even though I felt like something bad was going to happen. And the really eerie thing, because we ended up doing an emergency landing in Atlanta. And so my mom, my sister, and I went to the bar, and the name of the bar was the Spirit of St. Louis.
Oh, my God. Oh, wow. That's just so freaky.
It was so freaky because we were all sitting there, and I was like, I don't remember which one. It might have been me who said it. I'm like, do you think maybe we died in the plane and we're like in a waiting room?
And you know, if you wrote that in the book, nobody would believe you because the truth
yeah,
really
oh,
is.
Oh, I know. It's crazy. Wow. I mean, it was so surreal, and I think we were all so traumatized from the whole experience that we all kind of sat there and contemplated the possibility.
Oh, wow. I mean, just the landing alone must have been horrifying.
It was so, my sister kept trying to call her husband, and she must have done the sign of the cross at least 100 times.
Oh.
That's
all you heard was our father, what in heaven?
Exactly. It was
wow. Just
creepy.
So,
yeah,
I
very,
was
very
your intuition too.
Right. Oh, yeah.
The one time I can think of is we had a Rottweiler. Well, we had eight, but anyways.
Oh, wow.
We had this one that was just huge. I mean, he looked like a black bear, really. And I was in the shower. And for some reason, I thought I had pictured the propane guy walking down our walkway and Cassius, my dog, breaking the run and just ripping him to shreds. And it was such a strong feeling, and it's not like we were expecting a delivery or anything. It just came out of the blue that I jumped out of the shower, wrapped a towel around me, still shampooing my hair, you know, and I ran outside and I bring cash in the house, and not 5 minutes later, that propane guy walked down our walkway.
Ooh.
And like, wow. And the next day when Cash went back on his run, he broke it. So, you know, there's that, you know, it really could have happened. So now
I think
your intuition came in handy on the job.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it really did. You know, and that would kind of go with everything from, you know, when you're interviewing someone and you can tell they're lying, whether that's, you know, observing their facial expressions, or sometimes you just get a gut feeling that, you know, hey, this person's not being honest, or certainly came into play a lot with one of my first cases as a detective. I was only in for about 2 months, so I was a rookie for sure. And my sergeant at the time assigned me a missing person case. And the reason he did it is because the detective, the seasoned detective that actually got the case, a big home invasion came out at that time. So he thought, well, I'm going to give the seasoned detective the tough, you know, home invasion, the missing person case. They just thought it was, you know, some woman who had just gone to rehab and she was just, you know, missing but not really dead or anything.
Okay.
So, you know, so here I was, the rookie. He gave me the case. And almost from the moment I got it, I just got this nagging feeling that she was dead and that she was buried and that I had to dig her up. It was just,
wow,
you know, just imperative for some reason to dig her up. And so anyway, I investigated it, talked to witnesses, and I got an idea of a location where I believed her to be. And so I went in, you know, to my sergeant to try and convince him to let me, you know, at least call out the dogs. Well, he's kind of one of those sergeants who's very, like, kind of by the book and doesn't really, you know, listen too much to psychology or intuition or anything of that nature. So he did finally agree to let me have the dogs come out to the house. All six of the dogs, none of them alerted.
Okay.
So I went, So I went back and I said, look, I go, I know the dogs didn't alert. You have to trust me. She's back here. I just know it. I can't explain why. I just, you know, it was really tough to try to explain to him why I really believed she was back there. So anyway, this went on for about 2 weeks of me going in there every day to my sergeant, my lieutenant. I drew a diagram of where I thought she'd be. You know, I tried to give some backup information as to why I suspected she'd be there. Almost got fired because my sergeant was so angry. Yeah, he was so angry at me for just pestering him about this case, which no one was really, you know, questioning us about because I hate to say this, but she was of a type of she was a drug user, and
uh-huh.
I think and of course not in my mind that you know at all made her less of a person at all,
right?
But it you know there are certain like high profile cases where, you know, if it's a wealthy community, you've got a bunch of people, you know, asking questions where, unfortunately, in this case, nobody was really, you know, other than her sister, of course, but nobody else was really putting pressure on the department to find her. So,
and drug users can be transient, right? So there's
I think
question.
There was always that. Yeah, I think there was always that thought that, well, you know, she probably just go to rehab and took off and, you know, took off somewhere. So mm-hmm. It was so important to me to find her that I knew I was risking my job because I really think he was about ready to kick me out. And it was crazy, right? Somehow, some way, I convinced them to just let me take two forensic people out just to do like a basic look of the property. And we get out to the backyard, and I told our girl at the time, she was an archaeological expert, and I'm like, look, I'm like, there's a depression in the soil. And she looks at me, she goes, I think a dog dug that. I go, no.
God.
I go, I think that's a depression in the soil. So we actually started arguing. So they humored me, and they started, you know, raking and doing their whole little how they kind of do a dig. They do it very methodically. And about 20 minutes later, we found a skull. And
wow.
We found her body.
In the exact
place it was,
you drew. The
it
exact
was
spot.
Exact. It was almost as exact as you can get. And, and by that point in the investigation, I did have some corroborating evidence that she would be there. It wasn't just my gut. It was initially, but then I was able to get some corroboration to that. But it was just very surreal. So my lieutenant after that, that's when he started calling me the mystic at work.
I bet he wanted to step it in his face and say,
I told you.
Right?
I know, right?
But how
exactly.
Awesome. That victim might never have gotten justice if it weren't for you. Ever.
Yeah, and it was really so wonderful because her sister, every year she calls me and she'll call me on Christmas, special occasions, and she's just so amazingly appreciative and wonderful, and you really do develop like that bond with your victim's family members because they just, you know, they just go through so much, and you just want so much to do what little part you can to, you know, ease their mind. But it was a very surreal experience, and I could never really explain it. But it was such a nagging feeling to dig her up. It was more, I think, than just personal drive or ambition for the job. I really felt like I had to do it. It's just inexplainable. It's strange.
Wow. And I bet that occurs often in law enforcement. They call it hunches, right?
Right. Even cops have a name for it, just like a hunch. And again, it falls on that spectrum of psychic you know, the psychic spectrum, because the same is when a seasoned, you know, captain or detective gets a hunch, what they're really saying is they know something, but they don't know why they know it, right?
So yes, I would think that would be the very definition of hunch.
So a hunch or intuition is knowing without knowing why.
And I think also, and correct me if I'm wrong, do you think the more experience you get, the stronger your hunches or intuition, because now you can apply, you know, your knowledge to that feeling, or does one not connect to the other?
You know, I wonder if it could almost be the opposite. Because sometimes you learn because I think you learn so much on the job that almost your intellect could probably take over. And it might almost kind of quash the hunch or intuition to a certain extent, because you know so much on an intellectual basis, you know, like, is that person looking to the left or the right, or are they, you know, displaying nervous behavior? So as opposed to maybe where you just sensed it before, now you could more articulate why you distrust that person or why you got that feeling. So, I mean, I think it could work both ways depending on maybe the personality of the investigator and if they've honed in on that skill of intuition, which probably in a way is a skill almost to recognize when, you know, recognize that ability or those like little subtle, almost like Jiminy Cricket, you know, telling you something.
And, you know, that makes a lot of sense, because it's always the mind that tries to rationalize why the intuition is wrong, right?
Right.
So that makes a lot
Absolutely.
Of sense. Interesting.
Yeah, you could almost talk yourself out of a good hunch or a good intuition based on, right, your mind kind of taking over, like, oh, I've worked 10 homicides now, so I know what I'm doing. I don't really need that little gut feeling you're right. You could almost talk yourself out of it.
Wow. Now, when did you ever have a case where they used a, quote, real psychic or, you know, your... In your department, did they use psychics? I don't know how much you're allowed to say.
Yeah, absolutely. There was actually, surprisingly, a couple cases our department had used psychics. I'm trying to remember the name of that show, which was the two girls. This wasn't my case. It was someone else's case, but Sensing Murder, I think it was called. And they actually had them come down and work the case. Nothing really came of it from my recollection, but I was really surprised because I come from a pretty conservative department. So
uh-huh.
I was actually really surprised they allowed that to happen. But I think the family really pushed for it. And this was one of our unsolved homicides, which was a pretty big deal down here. So I think that's why they actually did that. In one of the cold cases that I worked, the In Cold Blood case, we had a murder in 1959 of a family of four here. And on that case, before I was a detective in the 90s, a couple of male detectives actually took the female murder victim was wearing these beautiful silver pins in her hair. And they actually took those pins. There was a psychic there in town at our local, like, arena. So they took the pins to the fair, and she's actually a pretty famous psychic. I'm sure you've probably heard of her, Noreen Rainier.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, she did a reading back then in the 90s and drew a picture, or had someone else, I think, draw a picture, actually, like a sketch, and gave some information, but unfortunately, by the time I got the case, there was no notes, no tape recording, you know, nothing was documented on this conversation with Noreen Rainier. And so when I got the case, I got it, and I asked my sergeant if I could speak to her.
And his response was, if you want to make yourself, quote unquote, stupider, go ahead.
Nice.
And, you know, actually, I didn't even mind the insult because he actually gave, because I got permission to talk to her, which I never thought in a million years. That's all I wanted. You could call me anything, you know.
Right.
Call me crazy. Call me stupider. Yeah. So, and I tell you, she is just a remarkable person. She's very kind. All the conversations I had with her, she never charged me anything. You know, there was no, she did it completely pro bono. And this was before the eerie thing. This was before I had identified Hickok and Smith as the suspects.
Wow.
And now, nothing she told me led me to them, but after I identified them and went back and looked at my notes from talking to her, there were some eerie things, and I'll just tell you one thing that I thought was super eerie that she said. We were just talking, and she blurted out, like, this random name. And, you know, didn't know what it meant. And, you know, like I said, I think it was like maybe 2 years, you know, later I identified Hickok and Smith. So when I went back and looked at the notes, the name that she had mentioned was the first name of the KBI agent that I did the exhumations of Hickok and Smith's bodies with. And
wow.
The thing that's funny about it is, and I don't want to say his name to protect his identity,
right.
But it's a very unusual first name for a male. And
wow.
So, it really struck me. I was like, that's really odd. Because what she said was, I've got, you know, let's just call him Sandy. I've got Sandy in there, and I don't know why. That's what she said. So looking back on it, I was like, that's interesting that, you know, that she mentioned his name specifically. So it was.
Did you meet her
person
or over the phone?
No, we only spoke on the phone. And but like I said, she's just a very kind person. And, you know, really, you can tell she really cares about closure for the victims. And so I really liked her a lot. It was really a neat experience for me to talk to her. And I'll be putting, of course, some of the things we discussed in the book. You know, once I get that first book out of the In Cold Blood series, I'll give, you know, the whole rundown of what we talked about. And the very interesting things that she said that tie into the case are really fascinating.
And let's talk about your trilogy, because I can't wait, honestly.
Oh.
The whole series is called Rewritten in Cold Blood, and there's three books, Akin to Murder, Infallible Witness, and Crossing Capote. Can you tell us a little about each book?
Of course. Well, I'm going to release the second book in the series, which is Infallible Witness. And the reason I'm releasing that one first is because that's really going to focus on the identification of Hickok and Smith as the killers and kind of go through that whole, you know, process of obviously a brief introduction to the murder here, but more focusing on them. And the reason I did that is because most people are very familiar with Hickok and Smith due to, of course, Truman Capote and In Cold Blood.
Right.
But that way, if they read the second book, then they'll be more interested in the backstory, which is book one, which is Akin to Murder. And that's going to go completely into the victims down here, their family, the early investigation, really just the whole backstory into that murder. And the third book, Crossing Capote, is going to be a short book, and it's basically just going to focus on Capote, his investigation, if you can even call it that. And, you know, he was a writer, not really an investigator. And basically just to kind of, not to criticize Capote, but to demonstrate some of the errors and some of the, as a writer, you know, some of his shortcomings, not being a detective, and also his relationship with Perry Smith, and, you know, how he was almost
maybe not able or maybe didn't even want to make the connections with the murders down here because he wanted his book to be published. So it's really just kind of delves into all that. But it's not really a criticism of Capote. It's more of an analysis, I guess you could say.
Because he had an emotional connection, and so that automatically clouds your judgment, right?
Absolutely. And, you know, that can even happen with detectives, absolutely. I mean, especially if you have a long-term connection, even with the suspect. And sometimes that happens, especially with cold cases. You know, sometimes you'll go to a jail or a prison or someone's home and interview them repeatedly, you know, in an effort to get little bits and pieces, or maybe to try to catch them in a lie or whatever, or build a rapport, whatever it is you're trying to do. There can definitely develop an emotional bond that even the detective or investigator is unaware of, that they may lose a lot of their objectivity. And so I think there's a lot to indicate that that did happen between Perry Smith and Truman Capote, especially those two. And, you know, Truman even really talked about, how he initially helped them with their appeals, but stopped doing so when he wanted his book to be published. And I think he even kind of said, you know, until they're executed, I can't really release this because there's no ending. So he definitely had some agendas and motives with, his interest in the homicides down here in Florida. So I think there's a lot to kind of pick apart there and to go into. And the other interesting points that I'll put in that book, particularly the errors in Cold Blood, are enormous in number.
The procedural errors?
Well, even the facts. Huge. And the reason that is because Capote was completely relying on Perry Smith to get him the story and the account. And this kind of goes back, you know, Zodiac, too, and some of the things we've talked about with my suspect in that case, is that people that interview certain serial killers can often get sucked into actually thinking they're telling the truth about everything. And the thing is that they lie and they tell the truth, so it becomes very muddy. And so Perry Smith was telling the truth about probably 60% of what he was saying. But 40% were...
He got all his information from the killer himself? I mean, that just... That's so wrong.
Pretty much. I mean, their timeline past the murders of the Clutter family out in Kansas, other than the stuff that, you know, that I have in my case, which was actually, you know, done by facts, like other witnesses, where we could actually put them places, Capote was completely going on Perry Smith's version of events. And,
wow.
You know, so like one striking example was Perry Smith said that Hickok and him were in Miami on Christmas Eve, and they were already way, you know, in another state. They weren't even in the state of Florida past the 19th, so
wow.
Which I can prove. So the factual errors, and there were actually some errors about the Kansas side of things too, and that could just be, you know, shortcuts or maybe not getting all the facts from the investigators, but there's mistakes on that side as well. There's really a lot to pick apart there.
Now, how did you get involved with that case?
I got involved, actually, it's funny, because when I first became a detective, after my buried body case, I just really developed a passion for cold cases. So I first started sneaking it. They had, in the captain's office in the Criminal Investigations Bureau, there was about 20 huge black binders, and they were all the 1959 cold case. Yeah, I mean, there was like 20,000 documents in this case. It was unbelievable. And this was after half the records had burned in a fire. So it would have been even bigger. My department spent a lot of resources back in 59, 60, early 60s on this case because nothing like that had ever happened here. A whole family being murdered just didn't happen, you know, in our town. So I started sneaking it. So I would just take one book at a time, and I'd sit at my desk, you know, at lunchtime and eat my lunch and just kind of go through it. And if my sergeant came by, I'd close the book really fast.
Yeah.
I didn't want him to see me reading a cold case because, you know, that had become a sore spot after, you know, we had exhumed that first female's body. It kind of became a rift between us a little bit because it's like kind of like the detective showing up the sergeant a little bit.
Yeah.
So that had become. What did you
say? The student far exceeding the teacher type of thing.
Yeah, and of course, you know, that wasn't my intention, but I think he might have taken it kind of that way a little bit. Like, it just felt like that there had developed a little bit of a rift between us, you know, because of that case. And so I kind of snuck it, but funny, it just happened in such an odd way because pretty much within a couple days, the case agent who actually had the case retired, and in that same, like, I don't know, maybe 24, 48-hour period, someone had called from the property where the house was, where the victims had lived, and said they were going to, you know, bulldoze the remains of the home, so we needed to come out for one final, if we wanted to take a final look. So my sergeant at the time, I think probably knowing I loved that kind of stuff, he assigned me to do that, and then he was so happy with, you know, because of course I went nuts on it and called out forensics and videotapes, and it was like the most thorough crime scene ever. So I think he was so happy that he actually, the next day, the case was assigned to me. So, and I write about that in the book that, you know, he was like Santa Claus to me at that point because after all we had been through, he still gave me the case, which I just loved him after that. So,
yeah, and you had been speaking, so you had a really good handle on what had happened so far.
Yeah,
wow.
I had a good heads up. It was really fun. It was actually kind of exciting to sneak read it because I was such a goody-goody at work. I never violated policy, always followed procedure, you know, never got into trouble. So this was like the one bad thing that I did.
You naughty, naughty girl.
I know, right? It felt good to be naughty.
Zodiac settling the score, which I adored. I might have mentioned that a couple of times, like, you know, a couple hundred. But how did you get into that case?
Boy, it was another really weird situation. I attended a cold case homicide school in a little bit north of here, about an hour north of where I live. And, you know, it's funny because I'd been to so many schools. At that point, it was kind of odd that I went because it was during what I call my hell week, which is I have this week where it's like a bunch of birthdays and anniversaries and everything in my family, and I tend not to schedule events during that time because so much is going on, but for some reason, I just felt like I needed to go to this school, and so I ended up going, and there was one of the professors was giving a speech, like a presentation on a serial killer. And I, you know, had seen this guy so much on TV. I was like, boring, seen this, you know, been there, done that. So I just kind of started daydreaming. And now I kick myself. I wish I would have taken copious notes on this thing. But, he just made this, you know, he posed a question. And he had been talking about, you know, some of the behaviors of this serial killer. And then he said, because the serial killer in particular had been busted for certain crimes but not others. And so he was kind of asking the class, do you think he's responsible for these later crimes? And so he posed the question, do you think the serial killer changed MOs? And I was like, oh, definitely. You know, he's that weird that he's like that weird person that's not content with just murdering or, you know, kind of keeping to the same MO. He's like all over the map. And then I thought, well, Zodiac's all over the map. You know, he went from murdering couples to threatening to blow up buses of school children to threatening police to wearing costumes, sending letters. Like, he was just kind of all over the place. And it just kind of hit me. I was like, oh, they're the same person. The serial killer who's alive is the Zodiac. And it just clicked. And
it clicked all,
so,
like that while in class? Like that first day when you were presented with the evidence in that class, it clicked right away?
It was instant. It was instant.
Wow.
And it was just that overwhelming feeling of, oh, my gosh, this is so obvious. And when it clicked in my mind, I was like, I can't believe no one's figured this out because it's almost like ridiculously obvious. And
yeah.
So when I started, you know, going into like kind of that feeling, it was the same feeling when I had figured out Hickok and Smith murdered the family here. And there's something that happens in an investigation where, you know, like when you're like halfway through a puzzle and maybe like you have that one hard piece, but then you find it and then all the rest of the pieces just fit in perfect.
Yes.
It's that feeling. It's like once you identify that and it's actually right, everything, it's like it just flows. It's just like, oh, that fits, that fits, that fits. Oh, that fits. And it's almost like a river of everything clicking and adding up. So when I had identified Hickok and Smith, it was like, oh, he had a scratched face. Oh, she had a high heel, and they said she had scratched the killer. They stole baby dolls from the house. They stole a man's pocket knife. It was like boom, boom, piece after piece after piece. And the same thing happened with Zodiac. It was like, oh, they write, you know, their abbreviations the same. They write postscriptums the same. They both talk on, you know, call the police, and they say the same things, and they use east and west. And it was such a flow of information. I honestly thought it's almost impossible they're not the same person. Yeah, go ahead.
When I read your book and saw, because you do a phenomenal job of putting the two killers, like the handwriting samples next to each other, and the way you laid out all the evidence, I can't see how it could be anyone else either. And I'm a lay person, but you would think that another detective would have, well, you know, maybe this is where the experience overrides intuition thing comes in, because maybe in their minds talked them out of it, where yours kind of put all the pieces together.
Well, you know what's funny? One of the reasons I think it went over everybody's heads is, especially back in the day, if you think about Zodiac, back in the day, he would have been a poacher, which, you know, he would have been coming from the outside into the state of California, just like Hickok and Smith came from Kansas to Florida. So finding them, you know, like finding them just outright is almost impossible without something specific to bring that person to the table. So if the serial killer that I identify in Zodiac had never been identified as a murderer, that he wouldn't have even ever have come up. But because he was a serial killer and there was already such a plethora of information about him, kind of such a treasure trove, I don't really think the investigators in California would really even have any reason to look at him. There would never have been anything specific to say, hey, what about that guy? Because there are serial killers all over the country. So I definitely see where they could have missed it. Plus, when you are so inundated with a high-profile case like that, your mind is so cluttered with suspects. And this is the real getter to me. Yeah, the real getter is, because this happened to me in my In Cold Blood case. I had, last count was upwards of 700 people. And some of them actually looked really good. So if you've seen the Zodiac, So if you've seen the Zodiac movie, this is what happens. Like the suspect in that case I think he had like a Zodiac watch. He was kind of creepy. He was a pedophile. So you can have, I had suspects in my case that looked so overwhelmingly guilty. Like, oh, they had a fight with such and such, or they were after my female, you know, victim. They thought she was pretty or made passes at her. But like when you looked at the evidence, some of them, you'd almost be like, you could almost get an arrest warrant. They look so guilty. So that clouds an investigator's mind so much because there's so much information. And so I don't even think they would have ever looked outside probably their suspect pool, at least in, you know, initially. So I think it almost makes sense that if you're really close to a case like that, it's really hard to pull away from what you already know. Does that make sense?
Yes. You had the benefit of hindsight and looking at it outside, right? Okay.
Yeah.
People will be amazed by your theory. I'm just, folks at home.
I think so too. This is what I think you would have to believe the theory is wrong. There were two serial killers operating at the same basic time, like one starts, one stops, the other starts, that they both like history, astrology, that they take folk songs or folk songs and put them to poetry in letters to police. I mean, it's very specific. So you'd have to have two serial killers that have the most bizarre stuff in common I can't wrap my brain around that set of coincidences. That would just be so weird.
They spelled the same words wrong, right?
They spelled the same words wrong. They both use cryptic letters. They both use like fractional codes. They both used actually the same type of expressions in their letters. But I think the problem is now for them to go back and connect these now, then they would have to admit that someone else figured it out. I think there could be some male egos involved in this one, to be honest with you.
Really? So that's what, and you guys call that what? Politics? Is there a term for that?
Yeah, I guess politics would be a good word because, I mean, let's put it this way. The FBI, I did public records request what a year ago now, and they still won't give me anything.
Wow. And
which I
really,
think is
they'll,
odd.
They'd rather let a case go remain cold than admit fault. That's really wrong.
Yeah, and I could be wrong. That's just a suspicion that I have, you know, that it could be that, or it could be that maybe they know something and they can't prove it, they know something entirely different that disproves it completely, but certainly nothing that, you know, I've seen. So, but yeah, very, very fascinating stuff.
Now, let me ask you, getting back to psychics, when a high-profile case or even just high-profile in your area comes in, are you guys inundated with calls from psychics? I mean, there has to be a lot of crackpots out there that just want their 15 minutes. But I'm wondering if you get real ones, too.
You I think that would be a really difficult thing to decipher on face value unless the letter or phone call is so bizarre on it. Because, you know, with a lot of my cold cases, you know, they would preserve, thankfully, they would preserve all that information. And some of the stuff was quite bizarre. So you would get some where you could almost tell, you know, just from what the person wrote that they most likely suffered from some mental illness or some type of derangement because what they wrote was just so strange.
Can you give us an example?
One of the letters in the In Cold Blood case was from someone who was talking about dreams that he had, but he wrote some very inappropriate you know, words and things that he had seen or had kind of done, which were creepy.
Our confession.
It was a little strange. Yeah. So that was a little odd. But I think a lot of times what happens too is family members will write in and they'll say, hey, we want to use a psychic, or we consulted with a psychic and they've given this information or that information. For me, I always followed up on it because I felt like even if it was just out of being thorough or out of respect for the family, I still felt like that was something that I should do, even if I didn't believe maybe in that particular person's ability or, you know, whoever had a dream or whatever it was. I thought, you know, it certainly doesn't hurt to be thorough. So I always followed up on those, but...
That's so sweet, just because it, you know, it really meant a lot to the family. You went that extra mile. That's like, aw, you know?
Aw.
Really, really sweet. And
aww.
I bet that was really appreciated.
Yeah, I think so, because the way I looked at it was, you know, these people just undergo just the most immense grief imaginable. And I just felt, you know, I would never want to be in that situation. And I just wanted them to know that, you know, that was one thing I was just so passionate about was, you know, these families, especially the cold case ones, because a lot of times they get forgotten. And, you know, it was just always very rewarding for me to at least let them know that I didn't forget them and that I was going to do whatever I could, you know, to bring them that closure. At least, you know, something, you know, sometimes you can't, you know, you have the best intentions and for whatever reason, the case doesn't come together. But yeah, that was really, really important to me to try.
That must weigh heavily on you, you know, as a detective working a case, because you do have, you know, someone like you who has a lot of empathy for people. That must have been emotionally weighing.
Very, very much so, especially with a few. There was like probably 3 or 4 cases because I had quite a high, you know, cold caseload at the time. I had about 10 at one time, but three of them, the families were in very close contact with me. And so you develop that very close relationship and it does. It's a burden because you feel that weight of just wanting, you know, to get, I think it would be kind of like a doctor with a patient. I mean, I'm not comparing myself to a doctor, but when a doctor has a patient and they have like a mystery diagnosis and they can't solve it and, you know, they want to, but for whatever reason, it's not coming together. And so you feel like you're letting that person down, I think, to a certain extent.
Oh, wow. And, you know, that's important for crime writers to know. Because, you know, it's easy to just have the detective work his case and not create that bond. And I bet it would, you know, it really adds a lot to a story if you have that, you know, your detective have that emotional connection with the family. It would do a lot for
definitely. Yeah. Absolutely. And sometimes detectives would even bend the rules a little bit, you know, for that, you know, special case they're working or that special bond they've developed or, you know, maybe tell them more than they should or, you know, that's not always a good thing, but it does happen. So.
And I liked the word poacher. So a poacher is a serial killer who lives elsewhere and targets a different area. So when they're...
Right.
They live and kill in the same area. What do you call that?
That's a marauder. And
a marauder.
A good example of, yes, a marauder strikes within their own territory. So I think
I'm
a good example of, yeah, it's a good example of a marauder would be Jack the Ripper. I think it was a pretty widely accepted belief that he lived in Whitechapel. And so he would be if Jack the Ripper were committing his crimes now, with the I don't know if you've ever seen that geographical software that can pinpoint almost down to like a block of where a suspect lives. I think they have to commit a minimum of 3 crimes. But if they're a marauder, you can use that type of technology now to really narrow down where that suspect might live. And they use the profiling statistics and the past behaviors of serial killers to develop that software. It's really fascinating.
What's the name of the software?
Oh, you know, I don't know that off the top of my head, but I have it somewhere. I can send it to you. But, yeah, so poachers are always really tough to catch because if they don't leave fingerprints, let's say it'd be like someone coming from Indiana to commit a crime in Georgia. They come in, they commit their crime, they leave. And if they don't have any physical evidence they leave behind, you know, maybe the Georgia authorities aren't familiar with that person. They're not on their radar. They're not on their books. There's no similarities to compare them to. So poachers are always going to be the toughest to catch, for sure.
And they have no relationship with the victim either, right?
Correct. So. Completely strangers, yes.
Fascinating. But now,
even,
do poachers,
yeah.
Do they still go through the phases of a serial killer with the stalking and all that beforehand, or do they go in, kill, get out? Or is it case by case?
Oh, sure. They're still going to go through those same like, cooling off periods. The stalking behavior may be brief. You know, in Zodiac's case, he might not have had a lot of time to stalk his victims, so his stalking might be an hour. Could be over a weekend. Yeah, it could be. It would kind of be how you would picture maybe a pedophile at a schoolyard looking for a victim. You know, they know exactly where to go, you know, either college campuses or, you know, in Zodiac's case, or, you know, parks where young couples hang out, that type of thing. So yeah, that would be, the stalking behavior would be the same, but it would just be a shorter period of time.
And they know who, like their specific type, brown hair, brown eyes, whatever. Yes.
I don't think it's generally that specific. It can be a preference, you know, like some might have a preference for, let's say brunettes. I don't think eye color, they might not even get close enough to that person to even see their eyes. But usually race is, they generally serial killers stay within their race, generally. That's not always the case. But if you have someone like Zodiac looking for maybe young women, for example, if they're the main target as opposed to the males, they might just be looking for a young female, that simple. It may not be any more complicated than that. It might come down more, yeah.
So anybody,
more who's in, yeah.
Anybody
yeah.
can be a victim. Wow.
Absolutely.
Do you think they, we could really do a whole show on this, and we should, because it's a fascinating subject, and I have a gazillion questions for you.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do a show soon about that. That would be great.
Yeah, let's do that. Okay, I'll save my questions for that because I see we're running out of time.
Yeah, we are. I guess it's time to say goodbye. We could just go on and on. I know. Okay, well, that's it for today. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much for joining us.
And Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Partners in crime. We're partners in crime. In crime. Partners in crime. We're partners in crime, in crime. on a ride.